Well, hello everyone, and welcome to this brief live stream. I'm going to cover a few questions that are on the FME community today, and we'll see how they go. Hopefully, I forgot to check my microphone before we started, but you seem to be getting that okay, so that's good. So the first question I wanted to look at was this one. It was all about calculating the percentage of Nodata cells in a raster file. So basically, you've got a raster file and you want to know how many of the cells are flagged with the Nodata value. They were using the point cloud combiner and the point cloud splitter. Basically they're extracting the cells to get the Nodata cells out and then counting the number of cells. And there's another answer further down from Takashi, I think it was. Who suggested doing similar thing but with a raster extents coercer. But I figured that both of those, well, I know for a fact the user said that it was taking them quite a long time to get an answer for that. And I think Takashi's might not be that much better because the pulling the data extents out of a file can take quite a while. I tried it and yeah, it was taking forever as well. So what I did, and I've already put my answer down here, but what I did was use the raster expression evaluator with an expression in to say, well, if it's no data, then set it to 1. If it's not no data, set it to 0. So let's just have a quick look how that looks like. Was it this one? Yeah. So let me just rerun that again. I'm running this in 2022, just in case you probably noticed that. Excuse me. So we have a data set there, and you would think that that white square is all no data, but it's actually not, because I can zoom in and I can see a faint pattern to some of it. So if I click some of the different bands there, yeah, 255, I would assume. See, there's no data value set on this data, but I would say 255 is, and 254 for things like that, 249 isn't. What I did was I said, put this into a raster expression evaluator and turn it into an int 8 raster. And basically, if the A band and the B band, if band 0, 1, and 2, red, green, and blue, if all of the bands are not 255, then we're going to say it's not a no data square. And we're going to set that to 0. And if it is, if they all do equal 255, then we'll set it to 1. And that basically means it's a no data item. The help for the raster expression evaluator is quite useful. If you look in here, you can see some examples of how to construct that syntax. Where the equals is a bit not too obvious there. And the if statements as well. So basically it's if something, comma, then set the value to this, else set it to value to that. So that's what I'm doing here. And we can look at the output from that and zoom out. And you can see that all of the black squares there are actually where data existed. And it's now set to a value of, should be a value of 1. I don't know why it's still giving me numbers there. That is very odd. Let's open up the data inspector and just check that again. Yeah, value is 0. I think for some reason the data inspector was being a bit odd. So anything that had a value, i.e. wasn't no data, is now set to 0. Anything that was no data, oops, what happened there? We zoomed in a bit too far, and I've got the background map on as well, which doesn't help. Now, if I click on one of those cells, it should be set to 1. So we can see in that all of the white squares are basically what were no data. And so all I need to do then is run through a statistics calculator. And what I really need to calculate there, I was calculating the minimum and maximum, but that's going to be 0. 1 is going to be a maximum. The mean doesn't really... Actually, I was going to say the mean doesn't mean anything, but it, actually, I think it does. I think it tells us what the value is. We don't need a range, standard deviation, median, or mode. The mean and the sum. So what I was thinking was the sum. So if we know that this... let me just open a calculator up. So we know that this was a... the sum is 235,926. That's the sum of all the cells. But we know that if it's not no data, it's got a value of 0. If it's no data, it's got a value of 1. So that's basically the same as the number of no data cells. That's how many no data cells there are in this data. And what I can do there is I can say, well, let's divide that by, let's see, it was 1600 by 1000, which is the raster size. And there's a value, and we multiply that by 100, and that gives us our percentage. 14.75% of this is no data. And I thought, okay, well, that's the best way to do it. But I did just notice that the band mean value is also 0.147. So that looks to me like that's the one that we would really, we could just use that value. So 14.7 of that raster is no data. If I wanted to fiddle with that a little bit, I could say, well, okay, I'm not sure. Maybe anything where it's like 250, again, 250 and 250. Because, I mean, with this data set didn't have any no data, so it's got a little bit of odd, like you could see that area, you'd think, oh, that really should all be no data, and yet it wasn't. It was an odd mix. And the nice thing about this is it runs really fast, like as quick as that. And now we've got a lot more there that's no data, and we've gone up to 23%, so which is pretty much what I'd expect. So yeah, that's answering that question. And the really nice thing about that is it's quick, because if I try and put the Raster Extents Coercer, and you can do that. I mean, you can say, well, let's find out what the extents of my data are, and that'll tell us like what the area is of your data. Huh. That was quick. Last time I ran that, it took such a long time. And that doesn't look right to me. Oh, because I don't have a no data set. If I have Rasterband no data setter and said the no data value is 255, now it's made more sense. So yeah, now I run this and it's like, well, okay, it's having to take all of that and drop it into individual cells. Then it's figuring out which ones are no data, and it's sort of dissolving them together, and it's just taking quite a long time. I mean, it's already, we can see it's taking longer than it did just to pick the expression there. So we'll stop that. The only drawback with the method I used is that it destroys the raster, and if you wanted the original data together, that would be an issue. But what we could do there is just merge that information back. So we could say, actually, let's keep a copy of the original. And once the result is there, just merge that onto, merge the results onto the original. And then your merged is what we're taking there. And we just need to have some sort of ID for the raster, which we could get from the FME base name attribute, to be honest. So FME base name, match FME base name, and we want to accumulate attributes. by merging them on. So now if I run that, that should be very quick again. And what we've got here is the original data, but it's got the value 23% added onto it. So we've merged that information back together again. So that's, to me, was the quickest way of doing that. So that was the first question I wanted to cover from the community. And I'd already done that one, so that, so now that's a quick one to do. There's another one I already did as well. Let's see. Yeah, there was one other I sort of looked at. Actually, not that one. This one I wanted to, this question I wanted to comment on, because it was, how do you clip a point cloud to a boundary when reading into a workspace? So, for example, maybe I should just save this. Documents, FME workspaces. And this was no data counter. Maybe I should make that into a custom transformer and put it on the hub, because that really might be useful to some folk. Okay, so the other one, oh yes, the other one was about reading point cloud features. So if you have a point cloud reader, and we just here, I've got four point clouds, and let's see, format name, that's good. Yeah, so I got 4 point clouds, and they're fairly small. There was only like 8 million features, points in each of them, I think. Maybe some of them have got a bit more than that, but I'm just going to insert a junction here. And the question was, well, say I want to clip that to overlay it against a certain area. How do you do that? And can you do it on the reader? And if you do set a search envelope, well, how do you know that it's, like if I've got 4 point clouds and the bit I want to clip is only covers one or two of them, do I really need to have to read all 4 point clouds? Because that's obviously going to take up some time and memory. But I'm not sure that's the case, because I know in Raster that's not how it works. When we read Raster, we just sort of read it and say, well, okay, we've got a Raster file now. We'll go through these transformers and see what's supposed to happen to it. So we're clipping it, we rotate it, blah, blah, blah. Then we get to the end. It's like, okay, well, now we're going to write it. Now let's do all that clipping and rotating and whatever, and minimize the processing as much as you can. And I suspect the same is true for point clouds, that we don't read the data until we need to. Like here, if I hit the run button, okay, I'm going to stop that because I've got caching turned on. Turn off caching, hit the run button, and 0.4 of a second it read that data. Well, obviously it's not really read that data, I don't think. It's just read the header of those files and said, okay, I know about those files now, but I've not done anything to them. And if, for example, I put a clipper down, so those are the candidates, because they're being clipped. Let me put a creator transformer down. And I'm going to put a polygon. And I'm going to put a polygon that's nowhere near that. Quick tip, when you're building a polygon like that, you do the last point, then don't hit the tab button to go on to the next line. Otherwise, it adds another point on. Just click OK. So I've created a clip boundary that doesn't clip any of that data, basically. And I want to know what's inside. Well, if I hit run now, none of it should be inside because none of it really matches. And again, it ran in 0.4 of a second. So I think the lesson there is that it's not actually doing anything to that data until it knows it needs to. And here it got the coordinates from the header, and it knows that that clip isn't going to give me any data inside. So it just runs like that. It doesn't have to do anything. Let's look at some of that data. I just want to grab a coordinate so I can actually make a proper coordinate box in there. Okay, so minimum and maximum extents there. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a polygon that's actually inside that area. So I've got 491,500 just to make sure it's in there. 5458,500. And I'll just add, say, 20 onto that. Is that right? No, I don't need to add it on there because it's 5458,520. Oops. And that will be back to there. That should give me a... This should give me a square box that does actually overlap some of that data. So yeah, so now if I run this against the clipper, now it gets to the clipper and says, oh, actually, some of that does actually overlap. Now it's having to think about that and do the clipping, and it took 5 seconds rather than 0.4 of a second. So we know some clipping went on and some data came out of that port. So the important thing there was, when there's no clipping that takes place, FME isn't actually reading that full file. So the user on that question said their point clouds were 10 gigabytes in size. I think if you just did this, it wouldn't be a problem as long as caching's not on. So anyone caching's on, then we're trying to save the data at every step. That's when it starts to get slow. But up until that point, we don't need to read any data. And once we even get to the clipper, the only data we need to actually read is that ones that overlap. So I think this is a good way of doing it as any. I don't know if there's any log messages about fetching the data, but maybe not. One nice thing in 2022, somebody asked earlier as well on the community, can you go jump to a certain place from a certain message in the log? And in 2022, yes, you can. I can double click on that, or I can just click on it, in fact, and it will go straight to that location. So there's junction 2, there's junction 1, the creator, the clipper. So yeah, so once you, if you get an error message, it'd be nice if the reader was listed as well, but whatever. But yeah, if you find an error message in here and you want to know where it occurred, you can just click on that transformer and it'll jump to that point on the canvas, which should be really quite useful, I think. But that's in 2022, not 2021. So that's still to come in a couple of months' time. So that was a question on point cloud clipping. The other one I wanted to try and do, and I haven't done this yet, so we're going to find out if this works, is how do we package up extra files into a data download service? A file copywriter is basically the way that it should happen. But I haven't tried that. I mean, I'm sure I've done it before, but I haven't tried this in a while. So, and there is an article here. So I thought, so Takeshi says, use the copy file copywriter to copy the existing file to any location, and it should include that data. Let's see what the article says. Add a text file writer. Copy. If you want more files in the resulting zip file and don't want to modify them, you can use the file copy. Yeah, I don't think it needs. I think the only thing it does need is the source of that. I'm going to give it a try. I've not tried this before. I've not done it in quite a while anyway. So this might take a while to figure out, but we'll give it a go. So this is how we use the file copywriter to include different files in a data download service in FME Server. Oh, I like that. If you hover over one of these, there we go. If you create it in 2022, you get a little pop-up. Oh, I like that. That's fantastic. I had not seen that before. We can't get a preview there because it's an older build, but that's okay. Interesting. I did not know it would do that. Can we expand that a bit? I don't think we can. Anyway, so what was I doing? Let's create a workspace. I'm just going to generate a workspace. Something small. We'll go with the parks data. That's our usual demo data. And I'll just write it out to, let's go with GML. GML's always good. So we'll write it out to parks.gml. Okay, so that's that. Now let's say we want to copy another file in there. Let's see, what do we got that's in that parks data folder? There's a public trees.csv file. Let's say we want to copy that as well. So file copy writer. Select a folder for the file copy. This is where we're writing to. Actually, I should maybe do a different folder because it's already, that file I want is already in this folder. So there we go. We're going to write to the output folder. It's going to be a copy. We don't want to copy any subfolders. Overwrite existing file, blah, blah, blah. And it's plain text. I don't know that we need to copy that from the reader. I would have thought, well, let's see what happens with that. I would have thought that was a fixed schema that doesn't need, yes, it's got no attributes on it, that's for sure. Okay, I'm going to call this trees. Just for the sake of it, it's copying the data. We want to give it a name on the output and a source data set. So I'm going to put a creator down. I'm just having to look at my keyboard over the microphone if I'm sort of dodging my head around. Attribute manager. Let's see, what have we got? File copy, destination file name. We're going to call it markstreelist.csv. And the source data set is, actually, I wonder how that, where do I copy as path? I wonder how that's going to be with spaces in the name. Any spaces in there? No, there's no spaces, so it doesn't matter, but that's fine. So that's the source data set. We're going to copy it to that output folder. Let's run this workspace. And hopefully, this folder is empty. Why did that not work? Ignoring the output because the source data set was not a file. Oh. Well, I think it was a file. Invalid source data set. Data parks. Why is that invalid? Maybe it doesn't need the quotes around it. That's probably more than likely the issue. Let's try that again. Just proof you should look for warnings in the log file. There we go. No warnings in there. Did it get written to the output? Output trees, mark tree list. There we go. Okay, so it actually added the tree's name to it as well, which is fine. That doesn't matter. And the park should have a GML file. And 405 on the 14th and 1st. Yep, that's fair enough. That's 406 now, but that's good. So it wrote the data and it copied that file. So now what we should be able to do, I'm just going to save this and call it delete this workspace. Just so I know to get rid of it afterwards. So let's publish that to our FME server. And hope. Ooh, okay, yeah, that would be a mistake, wouldn't it? Connecting to an older version of server. We'll give it a shot and see what happens. Where's my folder? I thought I had an evangelist one, but no, but I've got an IMARC folder. So we are needing to upload the data files, select the files. This is the one thing that's annoying, is it doesn't know, because I've got the shape in now, I've got HTML, all called parks, and it doesn't know which ones are which. So we don't need DBF. We got dat, ID, map, tab. We don't want the XSD. Now the other one we need is the trees file. So parks, publictrees.csv. And let's go with that. And we're going to set that as a data download service. Okay. That's there. I just want to have a quick look at this to make sure I am doing it right. Full source dataset path. Okay, we might need to come back and revisit that. We might need to point it to the folder that the data is stored in on server. So we'll have to think about that at some point. Oh, yay. Let me try that again. Oh, man. Oh. Yes, I have forgot my password. Is it Mark? I'm pretty sure it's Mark I and not IMARC. I'm just going to try that just in case. One last chance, then we're going to change it. Okay, we're going to have to say I forgot my password. And I am just going to open my mail. Oh, I don't really want to do that. How do I drag that tab over here? Okay, there we go. Drag that tab over there. Recovery password. Here we go. New password. Oh, I'm typing and nothing's happening. There we go. Let's see where that gets me. Oops. Ah, it gets me in. Fantastic. Okay, don't need that information. Good. That worked. So what am I doing now? Let's see. We wanted to run that workspace, which was called delete this workspace. And let's see if this data download works. It might not, because it might need... I mean, I think I'll get the parks data in there. Whether we'll get the other file in there, I'm not sure. Because how does it know where to get it from? I guess I'll have to open that file. Oops. Yeah, see, it didn't know. It couldn't find that file. I suspect if I look at the log... Yeah, I couldn't find the source data set. So what I've got to do is find where it put that data, which was in the repository, I think. Okay, it'd be here somewhere. Where's my folder? There we go. Yeah, these are workspaces. How do I find the data? Resources? Maybe I should just do that in the first place and put it in a resource folder. I'm sure that will be easier. I mean, it might say in the log where it is, but I don't really... Okay, so what am I looking at here? Okay, so in the IMARC folder, I will upload that public trees file. There we go. We've got the public trees. So now I need to... We've done this before, I know I have, and of course I'm probably going to have problems with it, but user parameters, we want server parameters, and where are we? We want server shared resource data. So I just need to change this. Actually, I can probably get the parameter from here. Where are we? FME parameters. FME server shared resource data. / what was it? Mark I or IMARC? IMARC / public trees.csv. Okay, let's save that. Hit the republish button. Now I'm hoping it should work. We will have to see if that's the case. So there's my data download. Hit the run button. We download the data. There we go. File copy, output, trees. There, we've got the file. So this answers the question that was asked by this user, include existing files in the data download service. Basically, it's very straightforward, really. I mean, it took me a little while there, but it is pretty straightforward. All you need to do is set up a file copy. You basically want to write your files to the output, is what we're saying. And the easiest way to write them to an output is to just use this file copy writer and say just copy them because they exist already. Don't bother trying to read them in and then write them out in a different format. You could do that. I was reading CSV, so I could just read the CSV and write it back out of CSV and use that CSV writer in the data download too. But the better method is just to grab the feature, say, okay, it's in the shared resource folder, it's called trees, I want to call it this on the output, and send it to the file copywriter. And so when you go into server and run that workspace, it includes that file copy in the translation, and it should say in here somewhere, file copy, copying from data resources, data IMARC public trees to temporary folder, auto zip file, and then it gets zipped up with the writer output. There we go, zipping contents of temporary data set into zip file, and and then it puts it all into the zip file, and so you can include any data you want in the data download just by doing it that way. And I noticed that even though that was a 2022 workspace, it still worked just fine on 2021.2.1. So yeah, that was all good. So that was the answer to that question. So that's three questions we've covered today. Hopefully that was interesting. I was just going to look at a couple of others quickly as well. That was the clipping one. This one was interesting to me because I thought it was a fantastic solution to rename the year to be year one, year two, year three. With that number, Takashi showed, you just add the bulk attribute renamer and add that as a suffix. So anytime you rename the year, just add the number value onto the end of it, and then you get year one, year two, year three. I thought that was a fantastic answer there. I wouldn't have thought of that, I don't think. So I got to remember that one. That's a great tip to be aware of. There was another question. I mean, how could I not make this a question of the week? Was to say, I hope the user conference takes place because you really need a new pair of socks. So we'll see what we can do. Maybe we'll be able to get some socks sent out to you or something. But yes, well, I'm glad to see you're actually wearing them, Matt. That's fantastic. There was just one more thing I wanted to look at was this one. How do I check if any attribute of any feature has a specific value, e.g. string remove, and then you want to remove the attribute or renaming it? So to answer that, what I was thinking, and again, I haven't tried this, so I've got no idea if it would work. Let's add a reader back for the parks. Let's just run that quickly. Oh, I wanted caching turned on. It didn't. Wow, see, this goes back to what I was saying about the LiDAR last files. It read four LiDAR files in 0.4 of a second. It took 0.6 of a second to read this fairly small map info tab file. So that's why I really think the last reader isn't actually reading anything until it actually needs to do work on that data. I'm pretty sure that's how it works. Anyway, I've got caching turned on now, and I hit the run button. At least I think I've got caching turned on. Yep, there we go. I just want to say, well, let's find something that's... Okay, let's see. What was the question again? Let's make sure. Allows me to check if any attribute has a specific value, and then I want to remove the attribute. Renaming would work as well. So what I think the best way of doing that is the null attribute mapper. So the problem with this is if attribute value is So it can't do a contains. Like this says, okay, no. So it says if it's got a specific value. Well, that's fine. I couldn't check if it's got the word remove inside the value. All I can do is check if the value is that. So for example, if I say, let's look at the neighborhood name, what I could do is I could say, if the attribute value is Kitsilano, why is that not working there? Oh, okay, I need to put it in here. The value is Kitsilano, then map it to missing, basically. Missing will, I mean, you can't really delete an attribute automatically like this inside a workspace at runtime. You can delete attributes within FME while I'm designing this translation. Like if I go to the attribute manager and say, hey, I want to delete washrooms, I can remove that, click OK, and then washrooms disappears from the schema. It's not on there anymore. It was there, it's not there. But I can't do that at runtime because it's sort of part of the design. So the best I can really do is to say, well, look, if the neighborhood name is Kitsilano, then we'll map it to missing. We'll just say it's not there. And essentially, that's like the attribute not being there, but it's still recognized as being part of the schema of the data coming through. And it all depends on what your output schema is going to be, whether it's there or not. But anyway, if I run this bit, it should map anything that had Kitsilano to missing. There we go. Neighborhood name, missing, missing, missing. So in other words, the attribute just doesn't exist for that string. FME still knows about it. It still knows that it was on the input schema because I haven't deleted it completely. But as far as it's concerned, it's not in there, like so. Yeah. So that's how that would work, I think. And then at that point, yeah, I mean, you can do whatever you like with that. You can do that with selected attributes. So it doesn't have to be just the one. It could be all of them. So I could say if any of them contain the word Kitsilano, then map them to missing. Actually, I guess we could do a contains. We could use the regular expression and say, does it begin with the word K, for letter K, for example? And if it begins with letter K, then again, set it to missing. And we're doing that to all of these attributes. So that began with K and it's missing, and special features, well, that, I can't think of anything else that began with the letter K, so that probably wasn't a great deal of use, unless there was a park name that began with that. So yeah, there's no park names that begin with K, but if there were, I'd have got rid of them by now. I noticed there's McLean Park, Major Matthew Park, and that's in Mount Pleasant, so I could change that to M, and now there would be no attributes that begin with the letter M. Or the values be with letter M. So if I sort again by park name, we shouldn't find the Major Matthew Park there anymore. We find the any others we find there, but if they were in the, what was the M? I've totally forgotten. Mount Pleasant, that's it. If it was Mount Pleasant, now it would be null, because, or missing rather, because we said if it's got that, it's missing. So that is pretty much how I would do that question. Because remove the attribute, and even renaming, it's very difficult to rename something in the middle of the translation, because you have to define everything in advance, and then you hit the run button, and it can't, I can't say, oh, well, I'm going to hit the run button and it might disappear at that point, so just get rid of the neighborhood name now. It doesn't work like that. There's no way we can do that. We can't rename it. The best we can do is say that is missing for that feature. And now if I, for example, tester, see, again, it sort of depends what you want to do with the end of it. If I say attribute name is missing, I can certainly separate those out. But if I want to, write it out, I've got to have a schema to write it to. And that's where it becomes more difficult, because I can't just delete it from there if it doesn't exist. So even if I say, let's write it out to the parks folder, copy from the reader, like it's still in there. Neighborhood name is still in there, even though I know there's going to be no values to it. Because I can't really, what do we call it now? I've lost our parks.csv. Yeah, see, it's still got neighborhood name in there. It's just an empty field. So if you want to delete it completely, I really don't know that there's a good way to do that. The only way you could do that, I think, is dynamically. You would have to say, okay, these features don't have the neighborhood name, so I'm going to write a schema to do that. Actually, is there a schema? Schema scanner, there we go. That might do it. Schema scanner. Let's see what that comes up with. I don't know if the schema scanner will know that that's not there or not. Will it know that there is no... Okay, now where does it scan the schema? Where does it put it? Does it just put it there? Did it come up with neighborhood name? Park ID, ref park, park name, visitor count, tree count. Whoop. You know, I think it was pretty smart there. I don't think it came up with neighborhood name. So that's one way you could avoid writing it in the output. You could say, well, this is my schema. It'd be nice if we could... What I'd really want is to be able to map that into there and then say, okay, this is a dynamic schema definition and it comes from the schema scanner, but I don't know how we're going to do that, because the schema feature's not on there as far as I can tell. These don't have the schema on it, so we'd have to, I guess we just have to throw a feature merger on there. And just merge it one-to-one. And now I can say it's dynamic, get it from the schema feature. We can delete all of these attributes because they won't exist, or if they'll only exist if it's actually on the schema. Fingers crossed. So park CSV. Okay, so neighborhood name isn't on there anymore. So that worked really well. Now the problem it had is that it scanned the schema and it included all of the format attributes, which I really don't really want that. Like, how do I get rid of those format attributes? That's the question. I'd have to have a think about that one. But anyway, that did solve the problem. So we didn't know that neighborhood name was going to be missing from these. Or we don't know which features, which attributes are going to have that. But we can write that out with a dynamic schema by scanning it. So I'd never tried the schema scanner before. So that was quite interesting to see it does that. So yeah, I like that. I've never used it, but I think I could use that again in the future. So that's gone through about 5 different questions now, I think. So that's probably enough for today. So we just remember if you want to include, so to go over the questions we asked, if you want to add extra files to your data download service, you just need to include a file copywriter. If you want to remove any attribute, use the null attribute mapper and map that to missing, and then it counts that attribute as not existing. Clip into point cloud when reading. It shouldn't matter if you read all of the point clouds, because if it's clipping outside of your boundary, it'll just throw it away. It won't read it anyway. So I don't see that that's a time issue there. This one, yeah, I just like the solution that Takashi came up with, which I thought was great. That was the bulk attribute namer, renamer to add the number onto the end of the attribute for year. And yeah, socks. We really need socks. I don't know if there's going to be socks at the user conference, but there's definitely some that we've got now, so we'll have to see about that. Yeah, okay, well, thanks for that. Actually, what I might do